appreciate the Lord. I desire your prayers greatly tonight, both physically and spiritually. I need a touch from the Lord in both ways to be able to preach this to you. And I told Brother Sparks he should not have announced he was preaching. We might have had more folks here. Praise the Lord. But it's good to see Brother Dan.
Good to be with you.
And, just really good to see him come in back here. And turn with me to Proverbs chapter 25. Proverbs chapter 25. Try to preach here just out of one verse. It's very, very familiar. We have read it and read it, preached from it, testified about it. And I just want to try to help us here. Proverbs 25, verse 25. As cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country. As cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country. Thank God. I thought about that. As cold waters to a thirsty soul. And the point here is simply good news. And I want to talk about that for just a little while. I don't know how high it'll get. May not get high at all. May just talk to you. Trust the Lord to come by and help us. But you have to be thirsty to want it. If you are not thirsty, you're not interested. And if you're not interested, it won't help. The old saying we've heard more times than one is you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. I have done that and tried that several times. Owned horses. And in Indiana, had a place there that I fenced off a little section so they could get to a little creek that come through. And in the wintertime, that creek would freeze over. And so I tried to keep them water up at the barn and run the water hose and dump the thing over and bust it all out and pour fresh in and all that. And so I'd go down there and take a big chipping hammer and chip up the ice. And I'd lead them down there. Most of the time, they'd just follow me down there. And if they was thirsty, they'd take their nose and push the ice away and they'd get a drink. But if not, they'd just stand there like, what are you doing? And sometimes we're interested, sometimes they were not. And so, good news, I realize that all news cannot be good. All news is not good. It seems that everything we hear cannot and will not be good all the time. Got a deal that came on my phone. I didn't put it there, but it come on there. Some kind of app that was already on it. I guess to try to make me aware of the news that was taking place, and I can flip to the left or to the right, and there's several different topics that are being mentioned, and some even have little videos if you choose to look at it. And but nearly every time I'd say I could get my phone right now and scroll over to that, and there's not one bit of good in it. Most every time, the first thing that they start talking about is our president.
Yeah.
And most of the majority, that's what it's all about. And it's all negative. So it must be a liberal feed.
Yeah.
That's all I can tell. And we hear about wars and all this. There's nothing good about that news. The news of war and slaughter and killing and dying. There's nothing good about it. There's nothing good about the murder and the abuse in this hour. This world is messed up.
Right. Come on, Brother Steve.
They will allow children, babies to be killed by the multitudes.
Right.
But don't you dare put a bullet in the head of that old dog that bit the neighbor. Don't do it. You'll go to jail. That's twisted and messed up. Somebody has lost their mind. That news is not good. That news is not good for us at all. Amen. But when good news finally comes, especially when we've been waiting to hear it. Amen. I'm feeling better than I expected already. You've been waiting for the good news. It's like that drink to the soul, that drink to the thirsty soul that wants it and is interested in it. It's like the good news when you're waiting to hear it. Amen. There's something about good news that makes our hearts glad. And I understand that our hearts are not always going to be glad. And there's going to be somebody or something that will tear it down or attempt to tear it down every time you hear something good. Amen.
Cool.
But when the good news comes, see, there's a comparison made here in this proverb, in this particular verse. It said it's good news like cold water. We've all experienced that. Most of us have, especially the men, and I know the women have too. But nearly everyone has experienced that moment when you were so thirsty and you didn't want pop, you didn't want tea, you didn't want Kool-Aid, you just simply wanted water. Amen. And nothing was going to do it except water. Amen. What is more terrible than the pangs of thirst with no water? Amen. What is more fearful than a sin-stricken soul that is lost and on their way to hell? But just as cold water quenches the thirst in the natural, so does the drink from the well of grace. Thank God. Everyone in the room is saved, I believe, tonight with all my heart. You are. But I'm going to tell you, sometimes, Brother Dan, I've just got to go back to the well and find out that grace is still good and it still gives me a drink. Hey, but what about when I'm listening for news? And then the Bible told us here that it was good news from a far country. Where is that far? It's simply a distant place. But good news is bountiful and cheerful. Amen. It is doctrinally solid. It's doctrinally solid. Amen. It is joyful and kind. It's good news from a far country. It's a pleasant place. Amen. How about good news from heaven? Praise God. The place we were just singing about that is so close to us. How about good news from there? Can I tell you that our Bible is chock full with letters straight from that place. It's chock full with news that tells us that you can make it. I'm going to give you a drink. Grace is still sufficient, and the hand of God is still able to keep you. That is good news. Amen. Before Christ was, there was no way to get a drink. But thank God when he came, he brought within reach the gift of salvation to man from God. Hallelujah. Luke 2 and Peter 11, and the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David. What? Just another man? Just another name? Just somebody else to fill space on the earth? No. He said, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. He's not just anybody. He's the Savior of the world. And can I tell you tonight, no matter how bad Sister Kim, they talk to us, and no matter how ugly they look at us, he is still the Savior. Amen. He's still Christ the Lord. And we are still his children.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Can I tell you that it's still good news today? Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
To us and all we can tell it to. He's still our Savior.
Amen.
He's still our King. But I'm afraid in this hour the news has lost its joy and we're no longer expecting it much. Come on now. You see, people tend to forget that this wonderful grace that was presented to us. Amen. Sometimes we, part of the song says, look around today, we remember the glad things and number the bad. Not only was there a comparison made, let's look at the source. The source said it was good news from a far country, from the kingdom of heaven. And the thing that is so intriguing about it is, it's good news to us. And when we hear it, we know it's good. And it comes from a place we've never been. It comes from a place we don't know just a half of it. Woo, hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, Sister Minnie, but man, when it comes, it's good. Hallelujah. Maybe I missed the point on this, but I'm trying to preach the way I feel it here. We have a deep interest in the things that are in that country. We can go down the list. And probably the first thing we think of is loved ones that's gone on, that's already there. We feel like we've got an investment there. We feel like we've got a reason to push. We feel like we've got a reason to try. Amen. Can I tell you that if we're in trouble tonight and we've got troubles all around us, listen, we've got more than just loved ones over there to give us a reason to press on.
Right, that's right.
Right.
That's right. Yes, Lord.
We've got rest that'll one day come.
Oh, God.
No more sickness. No more sadness.
Yes.
No crying or dying.
Yeah.
Good. Lord, have mercy.
All be joy.
It seems like that's all we hear about.
Yeah.
It seems like that's all the media wants to talk about. Mm-hmm. Everything's so messed up. Mm-hmm. But here in Revelations 21 and 1 through 5, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Well, the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, where? Where did it come from? I heard a voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. You understand what it's saying here? And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. Listen, you can't take it away. It's already been written. It's already a promise. It's already something brand new. And it came from heaven. And God said it. And that settles it.
Right.
It ain't always going to be like it is right now.
No, it's not. Oh, God.
All the confusion. The lack of answers. The indecision. Sometimes we feel like every step we take is just in a, you know, I tell you, Olivia, we get her outside and I'm telling you, she's obviously not a boy. She's a little girl. But and it's probably her daddy in her, I don't know. But every time we get her outside, if there is a teaspoon water puddle, she's going to splash it dry. And she's going to put her foot in there. But sometimes it seems like every step we take, we're putting our foot in some kind of a puddle. It seems like mistake after mistake after mistake. Amen. Sometimes, well, that's the way I feel anyway.
Come on now.
Oh, it is. And all the time we're waiting for that good news. I told my wife just before church. She's going to be on. I said, I need to go to church tonight. And I need to hear from God.
Come on.
Oh,
God.
You're preaching good tonight.
Hallelujah. You're only there, God. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
I said, I need either God to speak to me.
Come on.
Or somebody to come to me.
Yeah.
And tell me something. That's what I need. That's what I feel like I need.
Yeah.
Maybe God's got a different plan. I don't know.
Come on.
But when was the last time you left home saying, I need to hear from God?
Right.
Look at the nature of this news. This news is good. I said good. No matter what this world says, it's good news. It's good because it tells them, number one, a finished redemption. That's what makes it good. Jesus came and gave his life for the ransom for all. John 17:4-5. I have glorified thee on earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. He finished the work. Not only is it a finished redemption, but he speaks about a home that's prepared. John 14:2. In my Father's house are what? Many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I'd go to prepare a place for you. Hebrews 11:16. But now they desire a better country, that is a heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. Hebrews 6:19-20, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil, whither the forerunner for us entered, even Jesus. So not only was there a comparison made, not only was the source from heaven, but there's a coming king. Isaiah 52:10, in closing. The Lord hath made bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations. All the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. All the fakes and all the phonies. All the charismatics and the make-believes. Are one day going to look reality right in the face. And it's not going to be like they thought. And even those that are claiming to be part of a Pentecostal holiness church that are just playing the part, just showing up, not packing their load, not doing what God's asked them to do, there's going to come a day when reality will step in.
Right.
And it's not going to be like they thought. Listen. It doesn't matter how many times or the number, the whole earth is going to bow down to this king. One day. One day. It's good news that says Jesus is still Lord. God is still God. And he is not dead. Come on now. He's not dead. Every false doctrine will have lost its power at that time. But aren't you glad there's still good news in a dark hour? A little confession to make. I was coming home yesterday evening, coming down the driveway, and we started out with two cats, and I guess the neighbor quit feeding his cats, so we wound up with three cats. So Michelle couldn't help it. She started feeding the neighbor's cat, so he stays at our house more than anyway. Coming down the driveway yesterday, And that one cat would always just flirt with death. Every time I come down the driveway, flirt with death, flirt with the wheels on my car until yesterday. He got a little too close. And I don't know where he went. I followed the blood trail, but I don't know where he went. Can't find him. I'm sure hoping he didn't get under my trailer. I looked. Couldn't find him. I pulled the underpinning back everywhere. And I thought if I just had a light bright enough to shine under there. And so I got me a flashlight. My flashlight barely would penetrate underneath there. But I got to noticing my watch, the sun was hitting my watch crystal just right. And there was the brightest light shining. So I stepped in my flashlight, or my watch, and I was shining back under that trailer with the sun. I'm telling you, it was bright.
It's good.
Listen, what's your point? My point is simply this. He is the light.
He's the light of the world.
He is the light.
Right.
And when we lose sight of the light, we become not interested anymore.
Right.
We become just part of the crowd or part of the pew or part of the carpet or part of something. Huh? Missing the point. Good news is still good.
Good.
Oh my goodness. I've knocked up too big, I can tell.
Come on now.
The other part of the good news is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is coming back. There's still a God in heaven. And there's still time to reach our lost loved one. Right now. There's still time. But the bright lights are shining. It's almost home time.
Good prayer. Enjoy.
You know what? I'm not that old. In some terms, that some folks look at age. And I don't think it's fair sometimes to look at just the age. You have to look at what that individual's been through and all that. And then sometimes folks that don't know you don't know all that. But when I was 16 on up to, I don't know, I think it started getting me somewhere around 35 or 6 or something. I started realizing, just like I said in the beginning, maybe the only relief I'm going to get is over there. I never thought I'd ever feel that way. But now I find myself saying like I heard the old timers used to say, Lord, come quickly.
Come fast, Lord.
Come quickly. Bring me that good news.
Good.
You know what the best news? Just like Brother Sparks was talking about, the prophecy. Soon, the Lord was going to move soon. And just like I said, we start thinking, well, this is going to do. Maybe that's not what he's talking about at all. Maybe Sister Kim, he's fixing to look over at that angel and say, blow that trumpet.
Come on now. That's right. Amen. Be good news, but he's ready. Be the best out there.
And I've often thought about that.
Yeah, blow that trumpet.
Where is that trumpet?
Yeah.
Where's that trumpet at?
Yeah.
Lord. I believe it's already in his hand. I believe he's ready. Now, I think it's kind of gross, but I've seen trumpet players. They hit that little spit thing at the end. They open that valve, blow in it, and all that comes out. That's gross. Do it over a garbage can. Don't do it on my carpet. But they do it. They'll be standing up there, you know, in the crowd. They just blow that stuff everywhere. I got a thing about breath anyway, and I'm thinking, don't get close to me. That's got to stink.
Yeah. Come on.
And then the next thing they do is they start working them valves.
Yeah.
So that they don't stick on a bad note or the off note and mess everything up.
Yeah. Right.
That trumpet, I promise you, doesn't need any work.
It's ready.
It's ready.
Ready to blow.
And you talk about good news. For the believer.
You're
not with me here.
Come on, Brother Steve.
Brother Tom, young folks, some that are not even married yet, but getting close to it, they're not on board with me tonight. They have no clue where I'm at, Brother Mitchell. They have no clue where we're at. But I'm arrived at the place that I'm about ready to hear that. Just a Debbie, that would fix it.
Come on now.
Wouldn't it?
I do.
That would fix it.
Come on, Brother Steve.
If he just said, blow that trumpet. They're coming to get us a song. Brother Tom, I don't know. Brother Sparks has always, you've always seen him doing like that.
Yeah.
Because he can't hear very well, and it does make you hear better.
Yeah.
It does. But I spiritually find myself cupping my ear.
Woo! Yes. Preach it now.
Hallelujah.
You ever put earplugs in? How many of you ever put earplugs in your ear? It's the most uncomfortable feeling.
Uncomfortable.
It makes you know what Brother Sparks deals with all the time. Huh? What? Huh? Because it blocks everything off. But I found myself spiritually, Brother Mitchell, in my prayer, in my daily life, and in my steps. And I found myself cupping my hand behind my ear and saying, oh God, don't let me miss the sound of the trumpet. That would be the best news we could ever hear. If your heart's not right with God, it'd be the worst news you ever heard. But if that trumpet began to blow and we left out of here to a better place, there'd be no more crying or dying, no more death, none of that stuff. No more bad news at all.
Come quick.
Sounded good.
Well, Steve, talking about that trumpet, and today, the funeral service, they had the honor guard. There was a veteran, and those old fellas, Brother Bill, are just about as professional as I and I ever seen. I've watched them, you know, the active duty people come in, and all the things that they do, and how professional they are, and these old boys really, really practice on that.
Yeah.
And he's talking about the trumpet today, and that one fellow Jack, my FBI buddy, and he's going to do some trumpet. And I looked around, all around that cemetery today, and I thought, Jack's not going to do that last part, that reveille, is that what you call it? He's not going to do that last part. Jack, where's your trumpet? Where's your trumpet? I was just waiting for that. Where's your trumpet? And everybody else was too.
Yeah.
And he had it back behind something. He walked over there all skipped. And he's going to do the trumpet. Angel, where's the trumpet?
That's it.
Oh. Well, you got it laying at, buddy.
Come on now.
Hallelujah. You got it all ready? Got it all ready? Got it all tuned up and ready? Hallelujah. It's about sound, saints.
Yeah.
I don't think I can have anything to what he's preaching.
Preach
I never thought that when he said that.
Preach one.
But I was waiting for that part. Because that's the most touching part.
Yeah.
Besides getting down on their knees and laying the flag over at somebody's lap. And the salute to the casket, that trumpet, is the most touching part. God knows what it's going to take to wake up this world.
Woo, right.